Well, hello again. This is the six-day online Bible school. My name's Maurice Barratt, and we're going through this book, Fulfilling the Law. It's the third book in the series. I suggest you get it and read through it. It's available from the website www.barrattministries.org.uk. And it's available as a paperback or a Kindle or a PDF. There's lots of ways to get the teaching. Well, this is study number 7 in the module, so we're getting near the end. There's only 9 in this module. A very, very important part of the Sermon on the Mount. Quite a potential controversial one, because Jesus says, I've not come to destroy the law, but to fulfil it. And he says, don't think, because he knows Christians will think, that once we get grace, then we throw the law out of the window. Just to remind you, I'm not talking about the ceremonial law that is thrown out of the window under the new covenant. So all the special ordinances, the feast days, the killing of animals, that's the ceremonial law. That's finished. We're now under grace. But the moral law of God will never change. How can God's morals change? They don't change from eternity past. In the new heaven and the new earth, God's morals will still be the same. God's character never changes. And so we throw out this moral law at our peril. And Jesus says, don't think I've come to destroy it. I've actually come to show you what Moses meant when he gave the Ten Commandments. That's a basic moral law. Of course, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, they add to it. So we've got an interesting study tonight. We're looking at the 6 examples. We found out that love fulfills the law. So it's impossible for a Christian not to fulfill the moral law of God if they love. It's quite simple. If I love my neighbour, I won't steal from him. If I love my neighbour, I won't seduce his wife and commit adultery. If I love my neighbour, I won't murder him. So love will fulfill the law. It's very simple. So Jesus gives 6 examples, and I would argue that these 6 examples will cover the whole moral law of God. And he starts by looking at the 10 commandments. The first one we've looked at, you've heard it said by them of old time. Let me rehearse it. Repetition's good. I want to brainwash you or renew your mind, which is brainwash you with consent. I want to renew your mind so it's in you. You've heard it said by them of old time. He doesn't say Moses says. He doesn't say God says. In other words, you've no idea what God meant. You've no idea what Moses meant. It's a tradition of the elders. You've heard it said by them of old time. But I say unto you, don't forget Jesus is fulfilling it. I say, fulfilling the law says, love says. And Jesus goes right to the roots. The root of all morals is not the action. It's the heart. That's the root of all morals. Adultery is only covetousness in the heart, wanting a woman that's not yours. To satisfy the lust, the desire, you do the act, but the act isn't the sin. It's the consequences of the sin. The sin is always at the heart. That's why God looks at the heart. We can't look at people's heart. We can look at the action and say that's sin. We should judge sin, but we mustn't judge the person's heart. That's God's job. The second one, you've heard it said by them of old time, thou shalt not commit adultery. But fulfilling the law says, lust is already adultery in your heart. So Jesus straight away says love doesn't deal with the actions, it looks at the roots. And then you don't have to worry about the consequences. Well, we apply the same criteria to each one. We check that it is in the law. Because Jesus says, you've heard it said of all that time. So maybe it's a tradition of the elders, maybe it's not. Well, the first one, we knew it was the Ten Commandments, thou shalt not kill. I think everyone knows the second one, thou shalt not commit adultery. That's also the Ten Commandments. But last week we had a different one. Not thou shalt not divorce, but if you do put your wife away, thou shalt give a bill of divorcement. So it's a commandment that you must free your wife. If you put her away, you must free her to marry another man. This was the law. And you must put it in writing. It's always to protect the underdog. God always protects the widows, the orphan, the woman who's put away. You must free her. Otherwise, she'd commit adultery. Well, we found that wasn't the Ten Commandments, but it is in the law. So we're up to verse 33. Let me just read it again. You've heard it said by them of old time. Just like a fishwife's tales, it's been passed on. You've no idea what God really meant. Thou shalt not forswear thyself. Thou shalt not make an oath and break it. That's what forswearing is. To swear on oath and then break it. Well, that's not the Ten Commandments, is it? That doesn't ring a bell. We need to check if that's in the Old Testament. We'll look in a minute. But thou shalt perform unto the Lord thine oaths. But I say unto you, so fulfilling the law says, love says, the new covenant says, swear not at all. Don't make any vows. Neither by heaven, it's God's throne, neither by earth, it's his footstool, neither by Jerusalem, for it's the city of the great king. Gives three examples there. I believe that covers everything. And the fourth example, neither swear by thy head, because thou canst not make one hair white or black. The conclusion, let your communication be yes, yes, or no, no, for whatever is more than this cometh of evil. Quite strong, isn't it? Anything more than that cometh of evil, will bring disaster. Well, is it in the Old Testament, thou shalt not forswear thyself? Yes, it is. So let's look at it. It's the first mention is Leviticus. I hope you've got your Bibles. You need to check out any preacher, including me. I'm reading from the Authorised, so I suggest if you're serious about going through the studies, there's over 60, so it's worth buying a Bible to go through 60 studies, and then we're all reading from the same version. You won't have any problems with what I'm saying. And this is Leviticus chapter 19. Verse 12. Here it is. This is Jesus quoting. Remember, Jesus was the Word made flesh. Jesus was the Old Testament in flesh, the Word. That's what the Word was. There was no New Testament. So when it said he was the Word made flesh, it meant he was the law and the prophets. Made flesh, that's why Jesus says, I've not come to destroy it. I am the law and the prophets. I'm the Word made flesh. Fancy is rubbishing the law and the prophets. When Jesus was the law and the prophets, a physical demonstration of the Word. The Word became flesh. It's not some mystical thing, it's literal. Jesus walked about in flesh and blood. The Word became flesh. And verse 12 says, ye shall not swear by my name falsely. Forswear yourself. Neither shalt thou profane the name of the Lord, thy God, I am the Lord. So it's in. So although it was a tradition, they didn't know what it meant, it is in the Bible. But there's another mention in Deuteronomy. It's good to look at more than one scripture, isn't it? You compare scripture with scripture. You don't take things in isolation and you don't take them out of context. So here's a little bit more explanation now. This is Deuteronomy chapter 23. And verse 21 says, when thou shalt vow a vow unto the Lord thy God, thou shalt not slack to pay it. For the Lord God will surely require it of thee, and it would be sin in thee. So he's clearly saying it's a sin to make a vow and to break it, and the Lord will require it. But if thou forbear to vow, if you don't vow, if somebody says, will you vow, will you swear on oath, and you say no, it's all right, it's not a sin. You can refuse and it's not a sin. But that which is gone out of thy lips, once it comes out of your mouth that people can hear and there's witnesses, thou shalt perform that thine oath, even a freewill offering, according as the Lord has thou hast vowed unto the Lord thy God, which thou hast promised with thy mouth. Not with the heart, it has to come out of the mouth. What comes out of your mouth, you can think it and it's in your heart and that's all right. But once you open your mouth and say, I will do this, God says, I'm requiring that. It's no longer in the heart. You've manifested what was in the heart. It's out of your mouth and God says, I'll require that. I think that's fair enough. You can meditate in your heart, should I, shouldn't I, should I, shouldn't I. But if you decide that you should and you speak it, you're committed. You're not committed while it's in your heart. Isn't God good? He allows us to, you know, to think about things. We don't have to blurt things out. Christians open their mouths too quickly, don't they? Think about what you say, because God will require it. You see, we're talking about the mouth tonight. When it says thou shalt not swear, it's talking about the mouth. Control it. Don't just let things out. Think about it. You're not guilty while it's in your heart. When it comes out of your mouth, angels and demons and God hears it. The devil can't hear it when it's in your heart, so how can he accuse you? But once it comes out of your mouth, and you break it, Satan, the accuser of the brethren, it's a legal system, can go to God and say, that man spoke it and he's not kept it. And God is a just judge and he will require it. But while it's in your heart and you haven't spoken it, Satan doesn't know it. He can't accuse you. We get accused a lot by Satan because we open our big mouth. You know, we must learn to keep things to ourselves. That's a wise man. Christians open their mouths too soon, don't they, without thinking. There's no excuse. You mustn't do things under pressure. I learnt a lot from my father, who was a commando in the last war. And so, you know, he taught me a lot of things. And he said, son, never make decisions under pressure. We were taught that in the commando. When you're under pressure, don't panic. That's why the general, a man called Nobby Clark, that was my dad's general at the back, he said he was sat 2 miles back on a chair. We were fighting on the front, the command. He was sat there, the general, because he didn't want to get involved. The message came back, they're bombing there, they're doing this. And those on the front were panicking, we need this, we need. And he'd sit back and consider what they need, because he could see the whole picture. And when you panic, you don't see the whole picture. So when you're under pressure, let me give you some advice. When you're under pressure, don't make rash decisions. Stand back, see the whole picture, Lord. What's happening? Get some counsel from God and make a wise decision. And then when you open your mouth, the devil can't accuse you to God because you've been wise. And Ecclesiastes, Solomon, the wisest man who ever lived, became the biggest fool who ever lived. Because if you're super wise and you backslide, you could become a clever devil, don't you? But there's tremendous wise sayings in Ecclesiastes, and this is one of them. Ecclesiastes 5. Verse 4. When thou vowest a vow unto God. Notice they're all vows to God. I know you can vow to somebody else and swear to somebody else, but we're talking about vows to God. When you vow a vow to God, defer not to pay it. Why? For God hath no pleasure in fools. Oh my. God's saying you're foolish, you're stupid to make a vow and not keep it, because you don't have to keep it. You don't have to open your mouth. Defer not to pay it, for God hath no pleasure in fools. Pay which thou hast vowed. And Solomon gives the wise advice again. Better it is that thou shouldest not vow. Think about it before you open your mouth. I'm going to read my Bible every day. I'm going to get more dedicated. I'm going to win souls. I'm going to do this. How many people say that in an emotional meeting? I'm going to give more money to the poor. I'm going to support missionaries. How many people say it in an emotionally charged meeting? That's not the time to make the decision, unless God puts it on your heart, to go home and think about it. Am I going to be consistent? Can I keep it up? God doesn't take pleasure in fools, people who promise things and don't keep it. You're a fool to God. Better it is that thou shouldest not vow, that thou shouldest vow and not pay. Here it is about the mouth. Suffer not thy mouth to cause thy flesh to sin. Now, listen to this. Neither say thou before the angel, oh, it was an error, I didn't mean it. I didn't mean it. It's come out of your mouth. Of course you meant it. When you're angry and you say, I could kill him, then afterwards, oh, of course I couldn't kill him, he's my friend. At the time you said it, it was true, because that's a murderous thought and it came out of your mouth, so it must have been in your heart, or it can't come out of your mouth. If it comes out of your mouth, it's come from the heart. That's what the Bible says, out of the heart the mouth speaketh. So whatever you speak, you've got to own. If you call somebody an idiot, that's what your heart felt at the time. 2 minutes later, you've calmed down. So isn't it better to calm down first and then speak, and you don't talk all the nonsense? Don't say before the angel, oh, it was an error, I didn't mean it. Wherefore should God be angry at your voice? See, it's the speaking out, not the heart. And destroy the work of your hands. How many people's work has been destroyed? How many churches has God had to destroy, not Satan? That God destroy the work of it. How many businesses have collapsed from Christians because of this? It must be true. Why should God be angry at your voice, at what you said, and destroy the work of your hands? We always blame the devil for everything, but it said God will destroy the work of your hands. Don't be a fool. God doesn't take it lightly. All right, let's hone in more on the subject. I've got 3 points here. I don't know what you think. Maybe you've studied it, maybe you haven't, but it's for your consideration, accept it or reject it. I've got 3 points. Number one, a vow has to be on something or somebody greater than you. I've got a scripture for it. It's common sense, you'll see, but let me quote a scripture. Hebrews chapter 6. I can't go into it, but Paul's talking to the Hebrews. And in verse 16, it just says, for men verily swear by the greater, and an oath for confirmation is to them an end of all strife. You swear by the greater. In other words, there's no point me swearing, is there? You know, I swear I'll keep my promise. And if I don't, you can have a pound. Well, anyone will break their oath for a pound. It's not valuable. If I say, if I break my oath, I'll give you £10,000 now, that's a powerful vow. So the vow has no power unless it's on something greater. If I swear on my dead mother, it counts for nothing because she's dead. If I say I swear on my child's life and she's 12 years old, wow, that's serious. That means if you break your vow, you can kill my daughter on my child's life. Can you understand? You have to swear something that's valuable, greater, something that you value. Unless it doesn't hold weight, does it? So it's common sense that. But there's a scripture that says it. So number one, a vow has to be on something or someone greater to give it weight. Number two, with an oath, with a vow, it only becomes legal with witnesses. If it's in your heart and you vow to God, it's not legal. It's between you and God, I understand, if you do it in your heart. But once you open your mouth before two or three witnesses, now it's legal, it's binding. Because you've opened your mouth in front of witnesses. And God says, you did it, there's the witnesses. Satan can say, Morris said it in front of witnesses. He can't say it was just in his heart, he opened his mouth. And number two, a vow or an oath, it's either a self-curse or a testimony of innocence. So a lot of the vows are curses, aren't they? They are in the occult. But we'll read one in the Bible. So may God do to me and worse, David said. So may God do to me and worse. And that was to be killed innocently or ignorantly, like a fool. It's about Abner, we'll see. He said he died like a fool. And he says, so do God to me and more besides, if I eat anything till the day breaks. So he's cursing himself. Or it's a testimony of innocence. As true as God made little apples or something to prove my innocence. So that's why we'd make a vow. To prove our innocence. To vindicate ourselves because we curse ourselves. It becomes legal when you open your mouth and it's before witnesses, and it has to be on something greater than yourself. All right, I think most people will agree with that. But let's look at what Jesus says. But I say unto you, fulfilling the law says, love says, don't swear at all. That's verse 34 if you go back to Matthew. Don't swear at all. So I have to ask the question, why would anyone make a vow? Why would anyone make an oath? If Jesus says don't swear at all, because we're talking about perfection now, aren't we? You know, under the law, I can put my wife away. God allowed me to put my wife away. But that's not perfection. God hates divorce. It's not what God wanted. God permitted it because of the hardness of our hearts. So Jesus says perfection is not to make any vows. He allows us to make vows for different reasons. But really, perfection is to say yes or no. Maybe it'll give you a clue. Numbers 30. I came across this and it gave me a clue as to why anyone would make a vow. And it makes me not want to make a vow when I read this. The top of my page says the law about vows. That's not part of the canon of scripture, but it's just explaining. I'll just spend a minute on it. It's interesting. I'll come to the verse that's pertinent, but if a man vow a vow, this is verse 2 of Numbers 30, and swear an oath to bind his soul with a bond. This is the key. Why would anyone want to bind the soul? That's trapping your soul. You're trapping, your soul is you. It's synonymous, isn't it? Look at that dear old soul. My soul is me, myself. Why would I want to bind my soul? Why would I want to trap myself and bind myself with an oath? I've got three reasons why people may do it. But if he swear an oath to bind his soul with a bond, he shall not break his word, he shall do all according to all that proceedeth out of his mouth, not a vow in the heart, everything that comes out of his mouth. Is it the same for women? Not quite. I don't believe in equality. I think it's a terrible satanic word, equality. God made nothing equal. Never has and never will. Even two blades of grass are dissimilar. Even two snowflakes are different. Why would God make anything the same? That's the devil, to clone everyone and make everyone the same so that he can control us. When everyone's the same, there's control. God made us individuals. Don't give up your individuality. Please do not be politically correct. Discriminate where you need to. I discriminate. I'm against sin. I'm against murder. I'm against adultery. I discriminate, of course. It's not a dirty word. If a woman vow a vow unto the Lord and bind herself by a bond, being in a father's house in her youth, and a father hear a vow and a bond wherewith she's bound her soul, and a father shall hold his peace, then all the vows shall stand. And every bond where she's bound her soul, it'll stand. But if her father disallows it in the day he heareth it, the vow will not stand. So the father has power over the daughter, that if he hears her make a vow, if he says nothing, that's it, it stands, that's great. She'll have to answer to God. But he has power to say, I'm disallowing that vow. And if he disallows it, although she's made the vow to God, God will not hold her to it. I'll give you an illustration of something that happened in my own family. And if she has a husband, so a wife who has a husband, when she vowed and uttered aught out of her lips whereby she bound her soul, this is verse 6, and her husband hear it and holds his peace, at the day he heard it, a vow shall stand. And her bonds, wherever she bound her soul, shall stand. But if her husband disallows her on the day that he heard it, then she'll make her vow which she has vowed and which her lips have uttered, wherein she hath bound her soul, of none effect, null and void. And the Lord shall forgive her. But every vow of a widow, because she's not coming under a man, that's the criteria, a daughter, my daughter comes unto me till she's of age. And if I give my daughter away, I give her to another man. I don't give her to independence, I give her my daughter to another man. Every woman should come under a man. That's for protection of the woman. This is nothing to do with chauvinism. It's to protect the woman, you'll see. It's always to protect the weaker. Whenever there's two and one's weaker, God always will protect and make laws to protect the widows, the orphans. And so on. So bind your soul with a bond. Why would we do that? I'll give the reasons. Let me give you an illustration. My sister, my younger sister, 6 years younger than I, she went to university to study languages. She went to Liverpool University. She came out and she went to Germany because that was one of her languages. She spoke fluent German. She went to Germany and taught English in a German school. Then she came back and got a job as a bilingual secretary. So she was very busy and she didn't really have any boyfriends that we knew about. Anyway, to cut the story short, she fell in love with a young man at the church. Hopelessly in love, really, really besotted. In fact, it was quite embarrassing because he was a bit younger than her, and in public she was all over him, and it seemed to me a bit over the top. But that's what love does to you sometimes. We understand that. So, but anyway, this man, I don't think they were suited. This man, I think he realised that my sister, who's like me, a strong character, I think she would have had him for breakfast, as we'd say. I think she would have worn the trousers, and I think he realised if he married her, he'd get trapped. They were going to get married. And so he backed out. That was all right, they hadn't got married. He backed out, and it broke my sister's heart. And I think she may even listen to this tape sometime, but it's my opinion, Liz. I felt she was embarrassed that she'd almost like made a fool of herself. A few weeks later, she came to my father. She said, I've made a vow, I'm going to be celibate. I've decided I'm going to serve God. Now, there's nothing wrong with that. I'm not talking about Catholic doctrine now. I'm talking about Paul. He said, I've decided to be single for the Lord's sake. That's all right. This is nothing to do with religion, okay? She decided she would serve God, and she's a strong-willed girl. Maybe she could have done it, I don't know. But anyway, she said, I vowed a vow, and I'm going to be celibate, and I'm going to serve God. I've given myself wholly to God. And she's a very sincere girl, my sister. And my dad disallowed it. He said, Liz, I'm cancelling that. I'm not allowing you to do it. It's null and void. She wasn't very happy with that. But when you have problems, you wait, don't you, and see what happens. Well, what happened? A couple of years later, she met a man from Scotland, Stuart. Fell in love, they got married, had six children. Seven children. My wife's just put seven, or is that seven? I don't know. My wife's just put seven children she had. They're all wonderful children. They've grown up well, educated. One's a vet and one's they're all sorts of. And she's going on with God, my sister. She's got a good husband, he looks after her. So my dad was wise, wasn't he? He realised she'd made the decision on a rebound. She'd considered it, she'd not done it impulsively, but it was on the rebound of this, you know, this potential marriage that had fallen down. And so there's an instance where somebody did it, my father did it, and she's been happily married for 30 odd years. So, you see, the Bible's right, isn't it? The father's supposed to protect the children. I'm supposed to protect my wife. And if I think she's done something irresponsible, I have power to say, no, you can't make that vow. That's not to make the man a bully or the father a bully. We're talking about love and protection. Please don't misunderstand me. I'm not giving a license to these men, Christians, who are bullies, who dominate their wives and dominate the children and won't let the children find God for themselves. So don't think I'm saying what I'm not saying. So why would anyone want to bind the soul with an oath? Well, for number one, to give you a backbone in the times of trial. The marriage ceremony is a good example, isn't it? The marriage ceremony isn't in the Bible, is it? They didn't have marriage ceremonies in the Bible. In fact, the Catholic Church introduced it 800 years after Jesus died. Nobody got married in church, but the Catholic Church started christenings and marriages and funerals. It's about control. Because you're not christened into Christ, as you're supposed to be, you're christened into the Catholic Church or the Anglican Church. So it's a way of control. And of course, What's death got to do with the body of Christ? In the Old Testament, you couldn't bring a dead body near the temple. It was dug, actually, it had to be thrown outside and go back in the ground. And fancy Christians putting dead bodies round the church. And the higher the church, we bury them in the crypt. And we think it's wonderful bringing a dead body in the church and we all look at it. It shouldn't be coming in. We bury it with dust to dust and ashes to ashes. It's wonderful to have a memorial service, isn't it? And talk about the life and praise God, but not with a dead body there. Well, that's glorifying Satan, surely. The corpse. Goodness me, that's not the person, is it? When they bury me, I'll be more alive than ever. Don't say anyone Boris is dead, will you? I've just started to live. Get rid of the body. That's the house I lived in. I've just changed house. You don't glorify that nor walk past it in the church, surely. What sort of pagan tradition is that? But the Catholic Church instituted a marriage ceremony, and if you ask them why, they'll say to keep the sanctity of marriage. And it's to give you a rod for your back. I know people, they're not Christians and they won't divorce. No, I got married in church. So it's a rod for your back when things are going wrong. No, I made my vows before God. So it gives you a backbone. So I understand that. People make vows so that when they would like to break it, they know they vowed to God so they don't break it. You shouldn't need a rod for your back, should you? You shouldn't need to make a vow. Your yes should be yes and your no, no. But that is why they make a vow. So it's weak and it's risky. How many Christians have made vows to Almighty God that they'll stay with this woman as long as they live, for better and for worse? And then when the worst comes, they get a divorce. They've broken a vow. They're fools to God. Better never to make your vow. All right, that's first one. To give you a backbone when trials come. Number two, to convince people of sincerity. To prove that I'm sincere. Have you done it? I swear. On my mother's life. Well, they know that I value my mother, so I must be telling the truth. So it's to convince people of your sincerity. I don't think under grace we need to do those things. I'm not worried whether you believe me or not, to be honest. What matters is, have I told the truth? I don't need to convince you by making a vow and swearing on something, do I? And three, to deceive diabolically. Because I work with gangsters and con men. And they'd knock on the door and they'd have a van full of carpets. Hello, love, I've come to sell you some carpet. I've just been working in a hotel and there's this stock left over and it's not stolen, is it, love? The old lady said, oh, as true as God made little green apples on my mother's life. Oh, and they'll swear everything under the sun, won't they? Oh, God strike me dead, love, if I'm telling lies. Bless you, God strike me dead. And so you can use a vow and an oath to deceive diabolically. So that's the three reasons. This is just my understanding of it. One, it gives you backbone in times of trials, I understand. But you shouldn't need a backbone in times of trials. You've got Jesus. My grace is sufficient for you. Not the vow you made, my grace. Number two, to convince of your sincerity. Or number three, to actually deceive diabolically. And let me ask you a question. A vow is only a promise with a curse attached, isn't it? I promise to do this, and if I don't, strike me dead. God blind me. Who's not broke the promise? I can't put my hand up. You know, this is serious. Christians should be people of the word. Daddy, can we go to the park on Saturday? Yes, darling. You promise, won't you, Dad? You promise? Of course I will, darling. We'll go. Saturday comes, I have to work. But you promised, Daddy. How many children's hearts have been broken because Daddy and Mummy didn't keep the promise? You know, it's serious to a little child. So we've all broke our promise. You don't have to make a promise. You don't have to vow. You say, if I'm not working, I'll do my best. Let's wait till Saturday, darling. I'll do my very best. Find ways that you don't break your promise to your children, to your wife. It's so easy, isn't it? I'm guilty of that. My wife said, will you decorate this room? And I said, yeah. When? Oh, I don't like it when they say when. They try and nail your hat on, don't they? So, I'll do it sometime this year. I'm giving as general as I can. But really, if I'm truly honest, I probably never intended to do it that year. It's just a way of saying, keeping the peace. I'll just push the barriers a bit. Well, I'll do it this year. But if I don't do it this year, I've broke my promise to my wife, who I love. It's not good enough, is it? I should have the courage and say, look, I can't promise you. Because I don't want to say that, because I want to please her, because I want a nice meal and some romance and whatever I want. Some men are good at creeping and telling lies to keep their wife sweet. But it's not good enough, is it? And I'm talking to myself. Are people thinking? I can hear somebody there watching me saying, yeah, but they made vows in the Old Testament. Well, yes, they did. Let's look at some. Good men made vows. But I'm going to show you it's risky. It's not perfection. Well, let's look at Abram. He's a good man, isn't he? Genesis 21. I'm not saying they were wrong. I'm not saying they sinned. What I'm saying, it's not perfection. And we want perfection. Under grace, we're not having a lower standard, are we? We're supposed to come to the fullness of the stature and the measure of Jesus Christ. So Genesis 21. This is interesting, because Abram had no intention of making a vow. He was just going about his business. And Abimelech took Sarah, and you know about it all. Verse 22. And it came to pass at that time that Abimelech and Phicol, the chief captain of his host, spoke to Abram, saying, God is with you in all that you do. Now therefore swear unto me by God. Here's a heathen man asking Abram to swear by his God, that you will not deal falsely with me, nor with my son, nor with my son's sons. It's quite a vow. If he said, Abram, will you swear that you won't harm me? Well, if he said, I swear it, that's one thing. But if he swears that his son and his son's son, how does Abram know what his great-grandson will do? You're swearing on something you have no power over. Do you remember what Jesus said? We'll come to it. Don't swear by heaven, it's not yours. Don't swear the earth, don't. He's swearing on something that he has no power to keep. Maybe he can keep his own vow, but how can he promise his great-grandson? Nor your son's son, but according to the kindness I've done to thee, that thou shalt do to me. He put him under obligation because he'd been good to Abram. And Abram said, I will swear. So Abram swore. But you know what? A few generations later, God said to Moses, go into that land and kill and wipe them all out. So maybe, I mean, when he said my son and my son's sons, he was thinking for perpetual generations, I don't know. But can you see, Abram's a good man, and Abram kept the vow, but he had no power over his sons. And we know human nature, don't we, that a good king was then followed by a wicked king who undid it all and backslid. So you've got to be careful. So, all right, he made it, and I think he kept it, but I'm just showing you it's not perfection. David made a vow. I'm taking good men rather than, you know, bad men. David, 2 Samuel. 2 Samuel 3, verse 35. This is the one I quoted before. Abner. Somebody came up to him and said, hello, how are you doing? And stuck a knife, was it in his back or in his ribs? But he expected it. It was hugging him and he killed him. And David said, verse 33, and the king lamented over Abner and said, Abner dieth as a fool dieth. Your hands were not bound, your feet were not in fetters. As a man falleth before wicked men, so fellest thou. You died like a fool. You got conned, in other words. And when all the people came to cause David to eat, while it was yet day, David swore, saying, so do God to me, and more also, God do so to me. Kill me like a fool. Let me be deceived and die like a fool, if I taste bread or aught else till the sun be down. Why did David make the vow? He didn't need to. When he said, caused him to eat, he could have said, no, I'm not eating. But he said, God do more to me. He cursed himself. And he said, God do to me and more. I think that was quite reckless, do you? He didn't need to say it. That's what Solomon said. Why make a vow and bind your soul with an oath? Well, David kept it. Thank God he did. So he's innocent. But I think it was a reckless vow. He didn't need to do it. He was the king. So he could have said no. And that would have been it. He was the most powerful man, so he didn't have to have a problem there. All right, well, those are people, good people who made vows, and they seem to keep them. But let me show you two more people, Judges 11. Boy, this man was trapped by his vow. Jephthah. Verse 29 of chapter 11 of Judges. I can't give all the history, but he became a leader to fight against God's enemies. And the Spirit of the Lord came upon Jephthah, and he passed over Gilead and Manasseh, and passed over Mizpah of Gilead, and from Mizpah of Gilead he passed over to the children of Ammon. Verse 30. And Jephthah vowed a vow unto the Lord, and he said, if thou shalt without fail deliver the children of Ammon unto my hands, then it shall be that whatever cometh forth of the doors on his land, amen, when I come home, whatever comes to meet me at the doors of my house, when I return in peace from the children of Ammon, shall surely be the Lord's, and I will offer it up for a burnt offering. He says, whatever comes, whether it's a bull, whether it's a sheep, whatever it is, the first thing I see when I come onto my land, the gates of my land, that's, I'll offer it to you. So, God took the vow and blessed him, and he won the battle. Verse 34, and Jephthah came to Mizpah, his house, and behold, his daughter came out to meet him with timbrels and dances, and she was his only child. Besides her, he had neither son nor daughter. And it came to pass when he saw her, he rent his clothes and said, alas, my daughter, you've brought me very low. You've broke my heart. For you are one that troubled me. I've opened my mouth to the Lord. I've opened my mouth, not in my heart. Now I've opened my mouth to the Lord, and I cannot go back. He took it seriously, very seriously. Do you know something else? The daughter took it seriously. That's amazing. She didn't say, oh, Dad, what have you done? Oh, goodness me. He vowed to the Lord. And she said unto him, listen to this. If you've opened your mouth to the Lord, do to me according to that which is proceedeth out of your mouth. For as much as the Lord hath taken vengeance for thine enemies of the children of Israel, you open your mouth and you've won the battle. You better do what you promised God. Don't break it, Father. It was her life. But she said to her father, don't break it, because you've opened your mouth and made a vow to God, and God has heard it, and you've won the battle. You can't go back. We're freed from our enemies because of your vow. And she said to her father, I've been in house groups, you know, talking about this, and people have said, yeah, but he didn't actually kill her, did he? It didn't actually happen. Well, it jolly well did. You've not read your Bibles. He did it. I'll read it and then you know. She said to her father, let this thing be done for me. Let me alone 2 months that I may go up and down upon the mountains, bewail my virginity. I'll never have a husband now. I'll never have a husband. Let me go and bewail the fact that I'm going to lose my life. I'll never be married, never have children with my fellows. And he said, go. And he sent her away for 2 months. She could have run away. How many girls would have run away? That's the chance. No way is my dad killing me. But you see, she understood the severity of making a vow to God like a father. And it came to pass at the end of 2 months, she returned to her father, who did with her according to his vow. So it's not debatable, is it? And she knew no man, and it was a custom in Israel that the daughter of Israel went yearly to lament the daughter of Jephthah, the Gilead, 4 days in a year. Goodness me, as we say, he's banged to rights. He can't win. If he breaks his vow to God and saves his daughter's life, he's broke his vow. That's very, very serious. If he keeps his vow and sacrifices his daughter, he's kept his vow, but he's sacrificed his daughter to God. Which should he do? Which would you do? I've had many a debate with my wife and different people. What would you do? You can't win. Whatever you do, you've sinned. You've sinned to break a vow, and you've sinned to sacrifice your daughter. He took what he thought was the best choice, and if he did it by faith, it wasn't sin. Because he'd vowed a vow to God, and God accepted it, because God blessed him and gave him the victory, so God heard his vow. So can you see how dangerous it is? He never for one moment dreamt that his daughter would have to be sacrificed. Jephthah was a good man. Jephthah wasn't a bad man. The Spirit of God came upon him and he did the battle. Is Joshua a good man? Joshua, of course he was. Joshua's a wonderful man. Be strong and of a good courage, Joshua. But he made a stupid vow. I'm saying that advisedly, stupid. Joshua 9, verse 3. Just the background, Joshua had come and had fought against Jericho, captured it, and then the battle with Ai after Achan had been dealt with. And when the inhabitants of Gibeon, this is verse 3, heard that Joshua had done to Jericho and to Ai, they did wily, cunningly, and went and made as if they'd been ambassadors, and took old sacks upon their asses, wine bottles, old and rent and bound up, and old shoes and clouted upon their feet, and old garments upon them. And all the bread of their provision was dry and mouldy. And they went to Joshua to the camp of Gilead, and said to him, to the men of Israel, we've come from a far country. Now therefore make a league with us. Well, of course they'd come from a far country. There was the evidence. Mouldy bread, shoes worn out, dust in the hair, ragged clothes, of course. And the men of Israel said to the Hivites, they were Hivites, giants in the Hivites, if you look back, a cursed seed, they had to be wiped out. Perhaps ye dwell amongst us, how can we make a league with you? We can't make a league with you. We've got to destroy all these people of the land. And they said to Joshua, we are servants. And he said, who are you from? And they said, oh, from a far country, come from a long way away, can't you tell? Anyway, let me go to verse 14. And the men took of their victuals and asked not counsel at the mouth of the Lord. They didn't ask the Lord. And Joshua made a peace with them and made a league with them to let them alive. And the princes of the congregation swore unto them. They made an oath. Because you're from a far country, we vow before God we will not destroy you. We're only destroying those of this country. Of course, as soon as they'd made the vow, they found out they'd been tricked. And what did Joshua do? He was caught as well. If he killed them, he's broken his vow. That's very, very serious. And if he keeps his vow, he's disobeyed God. He's supposed to destroy them. He's trapped. Can you see how he's bound his soul with an oath? He's trapped himself. And Christians do it all the time. They make rash promises to God. You don't have to do it. And so Joshua compromised, which is always a weakness, isn't it? He said, well, I can't kill you because I've made a vow to God, but neither can I just let you off, so you'll be our slaves. So it was a bit of a compromise. But being a slave's not being annihilated, is it? It's compromise. So, you know, if you think the vows in the Old Testament were good, some of them may be not sin, but it's not perfection. Jesus tells us what's perfection. Let's go and come to a conclusion now. Jesus says, chapter 5, I say unto you, swear not at all. And he gives us four examples. By heaven. Why? Because heaven's not yours. If I say on my own life, then if I break my vow, you can take my life. If I say, there's my bond, £10,000. If I break my vow, I have to give you the £10,000. But how can I swear on heaven? It's not mine. That's God's. It's God's throne. You can't swear on God's throne. Don't swear by the earth. As sure as God made little green apples. Yeah, they're God's little green apples, not yours. We were having a discussion over tea today. And we've said that everything physical, everything in God's creation is God's. It's not the devil's and it's not man's. We're stewards. He said, be fruitful, multiply, have dominion over the earth. We're just stewards to rule it. But it's the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. So those two cover all creation, don't they? Heaven and earth. Don't swear by heaven, it's God's. Don't swear by the earth, it's his footstool. By Jerusalem, why did he say Jerusalem? It's the city of the great king, isn't it? But Jerusalem was the holy city. It was separated from all the cities of the world. And I think Jesus is saying, don't swear by anything that's holy, that's been separated for God. Don't swear by the church or the altar or anything that's holy, anything separated for God. Don't swear by that. If it's separated for God's use, you can't vow on it. That's what holiness means. Separated for God's exclusive use. And don't swear on your own life because it's not yours. He said you can't make one hair black or white. You I've no control over my own body. If I want to be another 6 inches taller, which I think my wife would be quite pleased as it happens. She said she was looking for a tall, dark, handsome stranger and she got me. So didn't I do well? She's the one who came unstuck. I did all right. I got what I wanted. She got second best. But, you know, I can stretch all I want. I can pray all I want. I can stand in manure all I want. I will not grow. I can't make myself 6 inches taller, can I? I've no power over my own life. Fancy swearing on my own life, it's not mine. I can't guarantee I'll wake up in the morning, and neither can you. Your life's not your own. Your breath's not your own. Nothing is yours. You're a steward. And I wish Christians would get it in their head. They talk about my house and my car and my church and my everything. Listen, you could lose everything in a second, in a nanosecond, you could lose it like that. Your breath goes. How many people have been driving the car? God's just taken them and the car's crashed, but they've been dead before the car's crashed. So don't swear by heaven, the earth, Jerusalem, yourself. Matthew, Jesus talks about this to the Pharisees, Matthew 23, verse 16. Woe unto you, blind guides, which say, whoever shall swear by the temple. So he's actually now talking and telling them and exposing them what he said. Don't swear by the temple, anything holy. Whosoever shall swear by the temple, it's nothing, it's okay. But whoever shall swear by the gold of the temple, then you're a debtor. You fools and blind. For whether is greater, the gold or the temple that sanctifies the gold? And whosoever shall swear by the altar, you say it's nothing. But whosoever swears by the gift of the altar, then you're guilty. You fools, stupid Christians, stupid Pharisees and blind, for whether is greater, the gift or the altar that sanctifies the gift? Whosoever therefore shall swear by the altar, sweareth by it and by all the things that are on it. And whosoever shall swear by the temple, sweareth by it and by him that dwelleth therein. Oh dear. He that sweareth by the temple, sweareth by the temple, and by him that dwelleth in, that's God. God dwells in the temple. You're swearing by God Almighty. Don't you think that's serious? And he shall, And he that shall swear by heaven sweareth by the throne of God and by him that sitteth upon it. That's why I said don't swear, because God sits on the throne. So if you swear by the throne in heaven, you swear by the throne and God who sits. Who are you to use God to back your arguments? Who am I to say I swear on and God will back me up? You can't use God to give you a rod for your back. You can't use God to do those things. So Jesus is saying, don't bind your soul. Free yourself. Be free from bondage. A Christian's supposed to be free. If you make an oath, you've bound yourself. Why not stay free? Let your yes be yes and your no be no, and you're free. And all else is potential disaster. Potential disaster. It may not, but it may be. Why take the risk? Why not just be a man of your word? And people say, if Morris says that, it's done. You can bet your life on it. He's a man of his word. That's what I want to be. I don't want to have to curse myself to convince you I'm telling the truth or bind my soul. I just want to say, yes, I'll see you at 6 o'clock. I'll do that for you. I want to be a man of my word. It's hard work. Because we're all frail and we say things that we sometimes say will help people and we find we've overcommitted. I understand all that. Let me finish. Practicalities. I don't know what you do when you go to court. I've been to court many times and the judges say, will you swear on the Bible? I say, no, Your Honour. I'm hoping they'll ask me why, so I can say, because the book you're asking me to swear on tells me not to swear on the Bible. But I've not been asked, so they say, will you affirm, will you tell? I say, yeah, I'll tell the truth. Me yes will be yes, me no will be no. But I'm not going to swear by Almighty God that I'll tell the truth, because they don't want you to tell the truth. They say, I swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, which nobody knows, and nothing but the truth. Only God knows the whole truth. I can only tell you my perspective. Well, Your Honour, I was stood here and I saw this. I'm telling the truth as I saw it. But the man stood over there sees it differently. So I can't tell the whole truth. Only God knows the whole truth. What an oath they put you under. And how many people have gone to court and swore on the Bible and lied through their back teeth? And how many people have sworn on the Bible and said the truth as they know it, but it's not the truth? The truth as you know it isn't the truth. It's what you believe is the truth. That doesn't make it the truth. Go to a divorce court and see two sides, both claiming the truth and they're sincere. But they disagree, so they can't be right. Truth is a person anyway, not a statement. Jesus said, I'm the truth. Truth isn't in statements and doctrines and laws. Jesus is the truth. It's interesting. I don't know how much you know about false cults, but they all swear on oath. Witches swear on oath. Masons swear on oath. Church of the Latter-day Saints, the Mormons, did you know they have oaths? They curse themselves. It binds the soul with an oath. They bind the soul. The Masons, witchcraft, they bind the soul with an oath. Common swearing, it's interesting. You know, it's another subject, but its roots are in those things. They were often Christian things. In France, they say, oh, sacre bleu, sacred blue. It's the colour of the nuns, isn't it? Sacred blue. The worst swear words are the most innocuous. I don't know if you've thought about it. But when people use four-letter words, that doesn't faze me at all. It's just obscene. It's gutter talk. I've mixed with gangsters. That was every other word. And it's parts of a woman's body. It's sexual acts. It's just filthy talk. That's, you know, that's because in one ear and out the other to me. But, you know, if you say, damn you, that's a terrible thing to say. That means I hope you rot in hell. That's the old curses. I hope you rot in hell. So if you say damn you to somebody and people say, well, that's not very strong. Oh, yes, it is. Be careful what you say. You'd be better to say a four-letter word than damn you, than damn somebody to the lake of fire for eternity. That's very serious. And what about using the word blood, bloody? Why would you use that in front of another word as an adjective? What sort? Is it the blood of Jesus? Why would you use that word? And they say bloody hell. Why link those two together? These are serious, and those are the words that people just use. Oh, I would never use a four-letter word. No, they use worse. So think about what you say. You know, I'll just finish off with a scripture, Matthew 12. This is what Jesus says. We're talking about words coming out of your mouth, making vows, silly promises. Matthew 12:36. And he's talking to the Pharisees. Surprise, surprise. Generation of vipers. God's people. Generation of vipers. How can you, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart the mouth speaketh. A good man out of the good treasure of his heart bringeth forth good things. And an evil man out of the evil treasure bringeth forth evil things. But I say unto you, every idle word, idle, wasted, useless, unprofitable, unfruitful, they shall give an account thereof in the day of judgment. Not for salvation, that's by faith and grace. The judgment seat of Christ. You'll have to account to Christ for deeds done in your body, how you've lived as a Christian, Paul said. For by your words you'll be justified. Isn't that strange? Not your actions, by your words you'll be justified, and by your words you'll be condemned. I think that's pretty serious. When I stand before God, by my words I'll be justified, and by my words I'll be condemned, because I'm judged by my heart. But what comes out of the heart, you'll be judged. What doesn't come out of your mouth, you won't be judged, it stayed in your heart. But what comes out, every idle word, every wasted word, you'll have to give an account for in the day of judgment. So, let's apply the criteria. It seems as though this is a different study, but they're all the same. We can apply the same criteria. The law says, don't swear, that's true, but I say. So what's he saying? Remember, thou shalt not murder. What's the root of murder? Anger in the heart. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Jesus, forget that, forget the outward act, what's the root? Lust in the heart. We talked about divorce last week. What's the beginning of the divorce? Refusing your wife for two nights because you've miffed. That's the beginning of divorce. You've put her away. If you put your husband away and say, you can't sleep with me for 2 days, you've started the divorce procedure. Don't let the sun go down on your wrath. Make up before you go to sleep, because you've started the divorce in your heart. It may take 2 years to get into the law courts, but put it away for a day, for an hour, for a minute is the beginning. So don't wait till you're put away forever. Deal with the roots. All right, let's apply the same criteria. The law says if you make a vow, keep it. But we've seen that you make a vow because of weakness, because you need backbone, because you want to convince people. What's the root of that? The heart. Don't make promises. Examine what you say. Bring every thought into captivity and be careful. Guard the door of your lips. Guard the door of your lips. Out of the heart, the issues of life, but the issues come out of your mouth. So let's deal with the roots. And if you need a rod for your back, examine your motives. If you feel you need to make some great promise, some great vow, examine your motives. Why do I need to do it? What am I trying to prove? Am I trying to convince you? Am I trying to make a rod for my back because I'm very weak? Examine your motives. I've just got one scripture. And I'll say good night, a good evening, a good morning. Whatever time of day it is that you're watching. This is what James says. Of course, the Sermon on the Mount's all through the Bible. The epistles are full of the teachings of Jesus. What else can they say? Paul said, what I've received of Christ, I've given to you. It's the Sermon on the Mount, it's all through it. So what does James say? James chapter 5. He's talking about things and he says, but above all things. So he's making it very important what he's going to say, isn't he? Brethren, above all things, everything I've said, above all things, my brothers, swear not by heaven, neither by earth. It's quoting verbatim Jesus. It's the Sermon on the Mount. What else will the apostles preach except the teachings of Jesus? No wonder the church is backslidden when they won't preach what Jesus and the apostles say. It all adds up. Neither by heaven, neither by earth, neither by any other oath, but let your yes be yes and your no be your no, lest you fall into condemnation, lest you trap yourself and have to give an account to God. Well, I'll have to leave that with you. We've got another one next week. An eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. That's a tricky one, isn't it? I'm looking forward to that. I hope you are. I'm sure we'll get some revelation on it. Lord, please help us. Father, who hasn't broken a promise? Even to people we love, we open our mouths so quickly, so glibly, so much without thought. Lord, help us to take every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. Help us to stand back and see the situation and ask why we're doing what we're doing. Why we need to convince people. Why we need a rod for our back. Lord, let us be men and women of character, that our yes is yes and our no is no. Father, we long to face you and hear the words, well done, not wicked and slothful servant. So help us, Lord, during these studies to be built up in the most holy faith, to challenge one another as the day approaches. Help us, Father. And speak to everyone who's watching this video. Amen. God bless you. I've enjoyed doing the teaching. I love teaching God's word. It's the greatest job on the planet to be able to get revelation and preach the unsearchable riches. I wouldn't change my job for anything. I hope you're all jealous of what I do. See you next week for another study. Have a great week. God bless you.